With chilling stories of abuse by both patients and staff, it would be easy to see how the energy and emotion of the residents would attract paranormal investigators. Rumors and claims of paranormal activity have been gaining momentum, so we are staying 2 days and two nights in one of Iowa's most haunted locations. A friend in Kansas City told us about a place in Iowa called the Malvern Manor. At the time, it was a relatively unknown location with a lot of activity and reportedly tragic history. After John and I arrived, we were met by Jason Kupsick, our friend in the know and an investigator with experiences.
My name is Jason Kupsick, and I am good friends with Josh Hurd, who runs the manor, and I also built the website and promote the manor. I came up for an investigation with another group named Apex Paranormal, and I got here before everybody else did with a partner of mine, Mike, and we walked around, and as soon as we walked in, it was like 70 degrees outside that day. And yeah, buildings can hold temperatures, but it was probably 30 degrees cooler in the entirety of the building, even upstairs or in the attic where it should be warmer. And there was just a feeling, and I knew some of the history, but not all the history of the place, so I could have been affected by that.
Malvern Manor originated as a home built by I.B. Ringland in 1870. In 1890, the house was purchased and rooms were added, as the home became the Cottage Hotel. The hotel was the largest and longest lasting of the four in the community. Traveling salesmen would arrive by train and stay at the hotel. An Iowa road atlas in 1912 listed the hotel at $2 per room with service and meals. With the production of automobiles on the rise in the 1930s, weary travelers would press on to nearby Omaha and their homes, sealing the fate of the hotel. As times changed, so did ownership. And as ownership changed, so did its function. The building morphed from a hotel to a convalescent home and to a minimum care facility.
I started out in Gracie's room, and I was with Josh, and they split up and went and said, like this group that I was with, they would split up and go separately to different locations in the building and just sit for 30 minutes in the quiet and see what would happen. So I was doing that in Gracie's room, and Josh happened to be in there with me, and I started feeling this sensation of a touching on my ankles, on the inside of my ankles while I was sitting there, and at first I was like, you know, maybe my pants shifted or something like that, but the sensation, I couldn't get it to go away. And then it would come and go. And then at one point, Josh and I were just talking. We were just, you know, chatting because I hadn't, like, physically seen him in a while. And then we saw a shadow come into the room, and then the room got, like, it felt 20 degrees cooler. It's probably only really a couple degrees cooler. And then I start feeling that sensation on my ankles move up the side of my legs. And it wasn't, like I have my hands on my legs right now, and it wasn't that strong of a sensation, but it was definitely something pressing. And I don't know, wasn't like somebody was trying to sit in my lap. I don't know what it was. It was just a sensation on the inside of my legs. Gracie, she had schizophrenia and multiple personalities. So who knows if that was her, what kind of personality I was interacting with at the time, if that sort of thing carries over. This is called the nurse's station. And my experience here is I was sitting about 5 feet behind where I'm at right now, facing this direction, and I was looking that direction, and just back there, I saw what looked like a person leaning against the wall, shuffling towards me. It was just a shadow. I couldn't make out any definition of the person, but it was definitely there. And it had head down, and it was like just like shuffling along the wall like that, and I didn't see it come past this doorway over here. I've seen apparitions before, but this one looked like a scary movie. There was a lot of negative energy here between the staff and the patients. And maybe the patient, who knows, maybe the patient didn't even know who they were or where they were, and they just, their spirit happened to linger after they died. It's like anywhere else. If maybe somebody had an attachment, the previous person that ran this place before the last person had an intense attachment to this place, and she lived outside and she loved this place. So if you love a place and you're able to stick around for whatever reason, why wouldn't you stick around when you love? The attic, the small hidden attic, there's all kinds of reported footsteps that I've heard myself up there, going up and down the stairs or walking around up there while you're up there or while you're on the floor below. I don't necessarily know if anybody's seen anything up there, but I know that's a hot spot. And so is the rooms there where one patient was abusing the other patient, which is right underneath that attic. They'll see apparitions or spirit, or not spirit, shadow people go from one side to the other, is what I've been told. So I know another hot spot is the room on the top floor at the end of the western hall. They see a little girl down there that'll see running around or will interact with you. This place definitely has a darker history with the recent abuse of patients over the last 50 years. So maybe something could be attracted by that and come here. I don't know necessarily if Malvern, Iowa is a hot spot for evilness. But I do think that evil deeds can attract evil things.
For the first night of investigating, we had Jason join us.
This camera right here is going to be shooting down this hallway where a little girl has reportedly been seen and heard playing around. We're going to set some trigger objects up later on to see if she can manipulate them or hell, even show herself to us. So with this, we're going to try to catch that.
As Jason was walking around with our camera, we noticed a sound that picked up on the audio. Joined by Jason Kupsick, the night started quietly. In the room where a little girl was found hung, we all heard a door close.
Damn, that was loud.
Yeah.
That sounded like a door.
did, actually, yeah.
Let's go check it out. See if we can find it.
Let's go see if the door closed.
After a search of the building, we were unable to find the source. As we conducted isolation sessions, the activity at our base seemed to pick up. It sounded like somebody was picking up our equipment cases and dropping them.
So the guys are in here reviewing audio, and we've been one by one going upstairs into the hallways to do EVP sessions. It is my turn. We've been seeing the motion sensor on the DVR system signaling motion in one of the hallways, so we're going to go check that out.
Come on, darling.
Let's get this EVP recorder going. Warm up here. Is there somebody up here? What's going on? Mr. Hardcore Henry. If there's somebody over here, there's a door back there that they used to stick people in to, hide them, or to, not to hide them, but to punish them. There's a little room, like a closet. Do you know what I'm talking about? Was that you?
for a sec, I heard a whispery sound. Can you open that door to that closet? Might have to shut that door to the attic there. Hear noises in these rooms. Is that you making some noise? Can you make that noise again? Been hearing some sounds down this hallway, and I don't know where they're coming from, but as soon as I came down this hallway, they stopped. So I'm going to go down to this end of the hallway and see if they pick back up. Did you hear me? If me being down there made you stop, I'm coming over here so you can start doing that again. Make some noises for me, please. Feeling a breeze on my face. Could be just air current.
I don't know.
This hallway. You notice all these cameras around? They're there to take your picture, and we're trying to show people that you exist. We want to tell your story. We want to tell people about what happened here. It was a very sad thing. And I'm sorry they happened to you. Telling your story will make sure that it doesn't happen to other people. Is that cool? Do you understand?
The rest of the night remained silent. But the experiences were enough to get us excited for night two.
We had another great night at Malvern Manor. We had some interaction with the device. We heard knocking. We heard banging. We had things behind us. At one point, it did seem like we were in one part of the house and something happened in the other part, and we went down there. And then we were hearing things in another part again. And when I sat alone upstairs, I was hearing movement, like shuffling through the carpet. And hopefully, David comes up with a lot of great stuff to show you guys.
So we just wrapped up the first night of investigating. We're all pretty tired. Jason was great.
Yeah.
It was fun having him with us, and I think he had a good time.
Yeah. He caught some stuff on his recorder.
Yeah. We had some experiences that hit early on in the night.
Yeah, and had some stuff that was kind of unexplainable, like somebody was trying to take some of our bags out.
Yeah, a lot of the activity happened right here at the command center, and not as much around the house, but the stuff that happened right here was just peculiar.
Yeah, like somebody was trying to pick the bags up and walk off with them or something. You know, they started to pick them up and then they drop them.
So
you know, we're going to crash here in this room tonight because most of the activity has happened in here. Tomorrow night, we will be joined with Barry. He's going to make it up to join us.
Yeah.
And we're going to hopefully be able to get more evidence, more experiences, and more haunting history. Plug. So, fade to the next night.
Yeah. Use Barry as bait.
That'll work.
Yeah.
Good morning, everybody. Actually, it's about noon right now, and we've already had breakfast. We had an eventful night, and we got to walk around the town a little bit. We're going to get some shots of that for you. But right now, John's over at City Hall talking to somebody to see what he can find out about Malvern. We're trying to get some more information for our investigation tonight, some more ammo. And look, you know, we're going to go find John real quick.
You know who they think owns that?
Right now?
Yeah.
Isn't it Quincy?
No, Josh.
They think Josh owns it?
Yeah.
Why? Why do they think that?
I didn't ask him. I kind of like just let him talk about it because I didn't want to take and stir something up in case he had something going that we didn't know anything about. You know, I didn't want to cause
no rifts.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But yeah, they were.
Pretty nice.
Yeah. She said, well, you go on the website, and she just went on the website and printed it all out for me. Really great. Yeah.
In 1890, Miss Betts bought the Ringland House. She added rooms to it, and the cottage hotel, you know, is the oldest one or the longest lasting hotel in Malvern. So. But the history that in this book that they gave you, I mean, it doesn't go past Piper as the owner. And he was from the 1930s. After that is...
Well, basically, like this thing here was for the mural.
This is for the mural.
And this is just what they have. But that's why I say it. Probably the newspaper would be the next best.
So, John, what are we getting ready to do?
We are getting ready to go to the local newspaper to get more information on our location that we're investigating in Malvern, Iowa.
And this information was given to us, or suggested to us to do this, by the local city hall.
Yes, and they also gave us a wealth of information. They printed off the owners of the, kind of the current owners, and how much property it was worth, and how many bathrooms it had in here, and
let's go find out what we can find out.
Yeah.
Let's earn something for this mystery. All right. Most public places, they don't let you just walk in and film, so we're gonna shut this camera off, and we're gonna find out if we have permission to film in there first. If they do, then you'll get to see what we get to
see,
experience, and talk to them, and what we get to learn firsthand. And if not, then you know you'll hear back from us.
Yep. Later.
All right. Getting back into the truck.
That was fun and exciting.
So they didn't really have much information for us, except they did tell us to go to the library because they have CDs that cover all the books they have. They had books there till, what, the 1800s?
Yeah.
1880s, 1870s.
Yeah, George Washington probably used to drive through here.
But, you know, all that record is on CD.
For posterity.
Yeah. So we're going to go to the library and we're going to go check it out. I better hit the record button so it doesn't stop, or so it stops.
The library seemed to be a good source with all the newspaper articles, but after some digging, we again were steamrolled with fluff pieces Not exactly the info we were looking for. The next step was to talk with Josh Hurd.
My name is Josh Hurd. I am a tour guide, I guess, is a good way to put it, for Malvern Manor. As far as the history is concerned with the manor, it's really hard to come by, it's hard to find. So a lot of the history we've had to like try to piece together from people that have worked here in the past, people that have owned the building in the past. And it's really interesting. We know that it was built in the late 1800s. We know it operated primarily as a hotel for the railroad. Supposedly, it was the fourth or fifth structure built in this town. So primarily it was used just for the railroad itself. So on any given night, I mean, I'm sure it was booked pretty solid. Interesting story, like it changed hands like 6 or 7 different times while it was still a hotel. So, I mean, a lot of property and buildings changed hands many times, especially back then. But it's interesting because one of the guys that actually owned this place was here working one night, was leaving for the night, and right out here on the front sidewalk, just fell down dead. Nobody knows exactly how he died. Most likely it was something fairly sudden, like aneurysm, heart attack, something of that nature. But really freaking weird stuff, right on the front sidewalk. So that was like the first death like associated with this place. Now, since then, you know, it changed hands, and it was a nursing home, and then it was changed hands again, and it was more or less like what we would consider like a group home, halfway house or whatever for mentally disturbed people. And it ran the gamut as far as clientele. Everything from something as common as Down syndrome to the more exotic with your, you know, schizophrenics, multiple personalities, things of that nature. So literally anything in between was also represented here. Crazy, crazy stuff. This is what we call like the main lobby area of Malvern Manor. Back when it was a hotel, when it was originally built as a hotel, this was, you know, the main hub, where people would check in, and hang out, congregate, and things of that nature. So in its later years or whatever, when it was more or less like a group home, there was a client that would sit in this wheelchair in this room, and he was a non-verbal type patient, so he wouldn't speak, but he always had a transistor radio with him, just one of those little battery powered radios, and he would always have it pressed up to his ear, and he would always be whistling or humming along with the tunes. And it's kind of funny because still in this room we have a lot of whistles, sometimes humming, but whistling is the primary thing that happens in here. It's kind of funny, especially when you're, you know, playing music. things I hear are coming from, it seems like right at the top of the stairs. And it's sometimes, I've been sitting in there working and I just hear this, hello, thinking it's like Quincy, you know, the guy that owns the place just coming in and checking on how everything's going, and there's nobody around. Like, there's absolutely nobody around. So down this long hallway here, at the end of the hallway, is what we call the nursing home wing. The only reason we call it that is just because, you know, the doors are wider, and the floors are, you know, like that laminate or whatever. They're hard floors. And so this is the nursing home wing, obviously, with the cabinets, the med cards, the names that are still on the inside of the cabinets. It's really odd how they just kind of left everything, but place gets shut down, I guess you really don't have a choice but to just kind of jump ship. Down this direction here is where the majority of activity happens. This is where people have been seeing, especially over the last like 6 weeks or so, people have been seeing a great deal of, you know, what are considered as like shadow figures, you know, your stereotypical shadow figure that'll just break the light while walking across the hallway. But now, like I said, over the past 6 weeks or so, these shadow figures or whatever are seemingly now coming at you. And it's usually very fast. It freaks a lot of people out. Like all this information that we've captured,
yeah,
or that we've gathered,
mm-hmm,
the majority of the information comes from people that used to work here.
Okay.
So they knew the clients, they knew the people that were, you know, that called this place home. And one lady, I always keep names out of it. I don't really want to know names. It's small town Iowa and I don't want to piss anybody off, you know. It's just the way it is. I don't want to step on anybody's toes. But there was a lady that was brought in here to this room, room 7, and she was fairly young. I mean, like mid to late 30s. And she had something going on in her head that she thought, like, her husband didn't love her, he didn't find her attractive, and this became like an obsession, like even more than an obsession, where now she would stand at the sink here in this room looking into the mirror and she would rip her hair out of her head till, I mean, it was shorter than mine is now. I mean, and this was like an everyday occurrence, just more and more hair. So obviously they started medicating her. That didn't work. They heavily medicated her. And then she just slowly but surely began to deteriorate, you know, even more so mentally, physically. It's a horrible story. It's absolutely, you know, heartbreaking, really, like when you think about it. But at the same time, it's also a story that I think needs to be told, especially when you're trying to investigate the possibility of paranormal happenings. As far as Gracie's room goes, it's one of the more active rooms in the place, I guess, but it's at the same time, it's, I don't know. Like, yeah, we've captured EVPs in here. We've, you know, heard a lot of like bangs and knocks coming from this room specifically while we were standing in like that halfway point of the nursing home. But everything that we found, you know, here, we've left it. And I think it's important to tell people that, you know, we've, exactly how it is now is exactly how we found it. The most we've ever done is vacuum the floors, and not very well, and maybe dust a few things, and there again, not very well. So everything in this room was Gracie's. This is exactly how her bed was left. That is the exact location where her wheelchair was when she left. I mean, everything. Those are her glasses sitting on that stand, for fuck's sake. I mean, it's, everything is hers. So it's really crazy. But yeah, there's the story with Gracie anyway is that she was multiple personality. She was schizophrenic. So she had a lot going on up here, you know, in her head. And a lot of times, especially at night, whoever was working the staff that night would hear male voices coming from Gracie's room. So naturally, not wanting another a male in this room for many different reasons, they would obviously come and check, and it was always just Gracie sitting here. But she could shift and change her voice. The fuck was
Foundation.
That? Foundation.
It did that twice yesterday.
There is something. I'll get into that later. Remember that. Remember what just happened. Okay? But like, anyway, I don't even remember what the fuck I was talking about.
Is it creeping you out now? Or is that?
Nah, it's fine. I'm fine. But anyway, back to Gracie. She could shift and change her voice that much so it would sound like a male. And it's interesting because she always said the same thing. The devil's coming to get me. The devil's coming to get me. The devil's coming to get me. And it would just freak the fuck out of the staff. You know, like they were just absolutely terrified. But it's just, I don't know, very, very weird. So if you're ever in this room, Gracie seems to kind of attach herself, especially to males. She really digs the guys. This was actually the main office for the last guy that was running this place. This was his office. Now the guy, I just call him the guy, or I call him the dude, or whatever, because again, no names, don't want to piss anybody off. But he was not very well liked in the community. He wasn't very well liked by the staff, and definitely not well liked by the people that lived here. He was very verbally abusive, physically abusive at times as well. And just, he cut a lot of corners. He actually didn't even have the proper licensure to pass a fucking aspirin to somebody. His wife, however, had the proper licensure. He was piggybacking off of hers, her credentials. Like, he was basically using this. So in the state's eyes, I think it was all enveloped under her name and credentials. When
what was her name?
Not a clue.
Not a clue?
Now, it's interesting, though. The,
wasn't
the owners,
Geraldine, was it?
No, let me talk to you about her. Like, the owner before the dude, right, was Geraldine. Now, Geraldine was apparently kind of a hard ass, but at the same time, like, had a heart of gold. She's like my kind of people, you know what I mean? She's kind of rough and tough and gruff on the outside, but she's, like, just, like, sweeter than shit, like, on the inside. And she would do anything for anybody, apparently. I never had the pleasure of meeting her, but she ran this place until she was like in her mid-80s, until basically the state came in and said, you have to fucking retire. And so she was basically forced into retirement. She did not really like that at all, but I mean, she loved everybody here, would take people in, things like that. She loved it so much that attached to this fucking house is a trailer right out there where you guys parked in that carport. That trailer that sits there, that was her home, man. Like, that's how much she loved this place, is she put her home right up next to it. So, you know, it was kind of probably, I guess, a pretty sad day when she had to leave. So, and I mean, she's since, you know, passed away now, so. But, like I said, I never had the pleasure of meeting her, but she sounds like a super cool, super cool lady. In this room, like, I don't know. There's blood stains on the wall here that appear to be 3 finger marks. There's blood stains on the door here, again, look like 3 finger marks. Blood stains on the walls. Now, we actually had a group that came in, maybe a month ago now. They had that luminol shit.
Yeah.
It did test positive for blood. What it's exactly from, I have no idea. Like, people speculate, and there's all sorts of fucking stories, but I can't. So, this is another fairly active room. This is the room we call Susie's room. Susie apparently was mid to upper 50s, mentally more like 10, something like that. So there's a lot of coloring books, activity books that we have found. Again, we just left it exactly as we found it. I don't know why exactly, but it almost seems as if there's like a little girl spirit. We were filming A Brush with Evil 2 and started doing some really weird experiments as far as like sensory deprivation goes. So my wife had the brilliant idea to put me in a chair in this room, tie me to it, and then blindfold me and stick these fucking earplugs all the way down into the canal of your ear. So I'm hearing jack shit, nothing. And it was weird because then we had the cameraman basically standing exactly where I am, instructed to just be a fly on the wall. You know, he's not to react in any way, shape, or form. And I'm feeling like a pressure on my shoulder, like something's like poking me. I'm like, what the fuck is that? And then I'm hearing something in my left ear, or I say hearing, but there's absolutely no way I'm hearing anything, you know? Because, so what I'm perceiving anyway as sound is coming through as like a little girl's voice. Now, I'm the father of two young girls, so I have a general idea of what that sounds like. But it was just really weird because I couldn't make out anything that this voice was saying or trying to say. What was really interesting, though, is the camera that he was using, the audio equipment that we had strategically placed throughout the room, was picking up the same voice. Even, like I said, the camera he was holding picked up the same voice of this little girl. And what's really jacked about the whole thing is the cameraman himself, who was holding the camera, is not compromised in any way. Didn't hear a frickin' thing. So that kind of lends itself to, you know, frequencies and what we're actually hearing and not hearing and what we perceive as sound. It kind of speaks volumes, honestly. So this room is definitely my favorite. Yeah, so 17 and 18, these are the rooms that, I don't know, it feels like a lot of negative type energy or whatever. We get a lot of activity in these two rooms, a lot of EVPs, a lot of bangs on the wall, moaning, screaming, things like that. But as the story goes, there was a guy here in 18 that, you know, during the night shift or whatever, it was obviously shorter staff. So they would basically just need staff to, you know, do bed checks every hour, things of that nature. And this guy would, from 18, would mosey across the hall into 17 and sexually assault the man in 17. So I can't imagine what this man in 17 thought. But if it were me, and this was happening, you know, 3-4 times in a week, every week, like, I'd be afraid to fucking close my eyes, man. You know, like, I can't imagine that.
We were out here doing some photography for the show, and Van pulled up next to us, and Mike Jones here has an interesting background. Mike, if you'll tell everybody what your background is real quick.
Well, not a problem. My name is Mike Jones, and my grandpa Larry Foster and my great-grandma Geraldine Reed has owned this for many years. And, you know, there's a lot of story behind this. and it's been in my family for countless years, like I said. And there's a lot of good times, a lot of mysterious times.
Now, you haven't been in there.
I have not, sir. I have not been in this building for probably, I'm going to say, I'm talking 30 now, a good 15, 16 years. It's been a long time.
We decided to take Mike and his fiance inside for a tour and hopefully some more information.
You too, I love you, man. Bye.
Hey, before you call her, are you guys going anywhere in particular, or are you guys busy right now?
Not necessarily. I've got a few kids in the car. What's going on?
Well, I was going to say, you know, if they can hang out here for a few minutes, we'll take you in there so you can look around.
Yeah, I would really appreciate that. It's been a lot of years.
We just have a lot of equipment in there, and we don't want...
Not a problem. Not a problem. Okay. I will
just make sure check with her first.
Yep, I'll check with her. And I will move this out of the way though. Where the park is going.
Yeah. All right. So we just met the grandson of some of the former owners, and he's never been inside. So we're gonna take him inside. You know, at least we can do for the information. You know. So this is a cool thing. This is really cool. You just don't expect this.
Yeah, the fact-finding mission.
Yeah, this never happens on it.
It's been a very informative day.
So you were here too.
Her and I were together.
In high school. We would have the whole family get together.
We'd have Thanksgivings and Christmases and stuff in the dining room out there.
I'm going to take you a certain route. Because I'm going to show you something last.
That's fine.
Something I think you'll really appreciate. So.
Wow.
Let's go ahead and come here.
Holy shit. I remember last time I was here.
Careful with the cables.
And he was saying Gracie had a room down here.
Yes.
Gracie's stuff is actually, a few things of Gracie's are still in here.
I remember those glasses.
Yeah.
Holy shit. Yes.
The same. Couldn't touch him on her face, but you get to touch him now.
She had curly hair. And didn't talk the straightest, but...
Was her hair... Was she heavy set?
Yes.
Yeah, and she had black hair and had glasses like that.
Well, as far as the color of hair, I'm not 100%.
Well, I'm not sure. It was just dark.
But it was darker and it was curly.
Yeah.
Well, you didn't mess with her. I remember that. It's down the hall all the way down here to the right. And then you take another right is where Larry Foster's office was.
Really?
My grandfather's office was, yes.
The nurse's station.
Okay, nurse's station is here, yes. But then his office was right here. This was his office.
Right here?
Yes, sir. This was his office.
You want to go in there?
Okay, I remember his desk sat over here. And I come in here one day, and I wasn't very old at all. And one of his employees walked in and says, I need my paycheck, and says, I can't do it. And at the time, you know, I didn't understand, but yeah, that's at the time he was going under, but this is where he sat. You could just walk around his desk. I mean, there wasn't a whole lot of room. You walk in, his desk sat here, and he just sat right behind it. Wow. This is insane.
Like a trip back in time.
It is, brother. It really is, because, like I said, he just died a very short time ago, and it's been many a year since I was here.
You ever see a guy that always used to keep a radio up to his head? He always sat in that big room, and he'd always keep the radio. He didn't talk,
yeah.
But he always kept, but he'd sing and whistle.
Yeah.
Fuck.
Yeah, I do. He'd sit right against the wall. And he said, I want to say that table that he sat at was a smaller table. and he would sit on the south side of the table, facing north.
Do you remember his name?
I don't. But I want to say it's the same guy. He would do a number. He almost, we called him Boxer, because he always had his hand up right here, and he would always do this. He'd act like he was hitting. Whatever happened to him, I don't know.
Let me take you upstairs.
Holy shit.
Have you heard stories about the attic? Because, as far as City Hall's concerned, there's no attic to this place. The stairs are right there.
Was that door sealed shut?
No.
No?
The stairs are really super narrow. If you want to go up there, I'll let you take the flashlight and one at a time go up there. Yeah, I mean, they are super narrow.
So. Holy shit, I'll check it out.
There's a part of a chimney up there that now has, or that has molding on it. Not like mold, but like construction molding.
All right, yeah, I'll check this out.
And don't grab the rails, they're loose.
Rails?
At the top.
Oh, I won't grab that now.
Yeah.
Just to get myself going. Now I'm so fucking wide, I'll get snagged.
That's why I ain't gone up there.
Yeah, I have to walk down sideways.
You can go up there. We've been up there. Yeah. It's just dusty.
Hey.
You gonna film him?
You
want me to take it up there?
Yeah, you take it up there, Skinny.
Skinny.
Skinny Meanie.
Skinny Meanie.
Yeah, this is the chimney right here. Nobody knows where it goes to, comes from. It's brick up there. Now it's got this molding on here. What this was used up for, up here for, nobody knows. And like I said, in the papers we got from City Hall, there's no attic to this place.
Huh.
There's been a fire up here before.
Yeah.
Big time.
Yep.
And that plywood's been replaced. So it, I don't know, shit, it fucking tarred a lot of shit up here. Wow. And I've never been aware of any kind of a fire. So that's an extra support right there because that fucking charred piece.
This is what I wanted to show you last.
Thank you everyone for joining. We got about 5 people joined us here so far.
Photos, articles.
Center set right over there.
Wow. You'll appreciate some of these over here.
Wow.
Old photographs, articles, nurse notes.
This place is full of
treasures.
Interesting.
Yes.
Yeah, treasures. I was trying to think of the word. Treasures is definitely it.
That's Geraldine.
Yeah.
That's Geraldine right there.
They found it.
That is?
All posted. You know, where they were.
Geraldine and Jack Reed. That's Geraldine. I knew it fucking was. Yep, that's my old grandma right there.
Dang. So, I mean, we got newspaper clippings. We have photos. We have old documentations of people who were staying here a long time ago.
Yeah, that's scary, isn't it?
So happens to be a gentleman whose father was Larry.
Grandfather.
His name was Larry. And he owned this building for quite many years. So he knew a lot of stuff went on here. So this is just going to be a great night.
That's Grandpa Larry. That old man right there. Big old ass ears. That's him.
You know, one of
these.
He doesn't have his cowboy hat on.
Once in a while, I didn't wear it.
Oh, yeah.
Is that her?
After you get done doing it?
That's her.
Say yeah. Video to the camera roll.
Hell yeah.
Hey.
That's her.
What's that?
That's her.
That is Gracie.
The lady with the glasses.
Yep.
That's Gracie.
You can see the glasses.
There's the TV.
There's the TV. It's back there. And that's what I'm talking about. It's back there.
After basking in the photos, we had one more surprise for them.
She stuffed that son of a bitch.
Did?
And right over here is where it's at, right beside that fucking door.
Yeah, I guess I took it.
Wow. Somebody's been in here fucking around.
666.
666.
Yeah, probably stupid
kids.
Kids or whatever. Big old medicine cabinet.
Fucking wow. Look at this, boss.
Yeah.
Little shower head right there. You gotta remember, she was like 3 and
she
a half tall.
She wasn't very tall.
Now
she was shorter than me.
Now, is this any of her stuff?
Sense because he was very, yeah.
Otherwise, it's just gonna stay in here,
champion,
and get chewed up by mice and thrown in trash or something.
I appreciate that, guys. I'll take that.
Did you mind check the door? Maybe there's something else in there that's got left by it. Never know.
There'll be a fucking coon jump out and eat my face.
Say that.
Something's been up in that motherfucker.
It smell like a combination of dead roaches and rat shit.
Something fucked. Wow.
Yeah. Ooh. Smell it good down.
Cool.
Yeah. Run away!
Yeah.
Run away! Mm.
It's amazing to get to see stuff like that again.
Oh, shit.
You know?
It is. It is. When I seen you guys out there, I couldn't help but stop. It's like, and you know, my fiance and I, we've been here through here a few times, and I'm like, I see vehicles there all the fucking time. And I want to say it was in the last couple days I drove by and there was some kind of Dodge sitting out back and stuff. And
yeah.
I said, shit, I just want to stop. And she says, well, you should sometime. I said, well, they probably won't let me in. They're going to think I'm some weirdo or something. And she says, well, give it a shot.
Like I said, you know, we investigate the paranormal. We investigate hauntings and stuff like that. But, you know, a lot of it. Is you're investigating people, you're investigating history, you're living the history through investigating.
History, yo, yeah.
And that's, honestly, that's what our show is about. It's called Haunting History.
Walking
here.
And
a lot of it's about the history of the location.
This was her living room, big old couch, and shit, I'm trying to think. You know, back in them days, didn't have much to put in a place, but I want to say
it's just enough.
Yeah, yeah, the couch was there, and I think the TV was over here. I mean, very, very little. You know, this is where we had everything. You know, Thanksgiving and Christmas was the main two, obviously. Everything else, not so much a big deal. But them two holidays, this is where the entire family get your ass here. This is where we're at. And even the residents, you know, don't get me wrong, even the residents that lived here, they were part of the family.
Yeah.
As out there as most of them were, they were part of the family.
From what I hear about Geraldine, you know, she would take him in as family.
She would.
You know,
now.
She would. She wouldn't. Put them on everything. She wouldn't tell anybody no. Yep. She would not. She would take anybody in. I'm telling you what, there were fucking people here. They might be walking down the street and she'd see them. And they could throw her any kind of story. Well, come on in, I got a bed for you. I'll get you a bed. It didn't matter. Right. Bullshit or not, got a bed for you.
Yeah.
I mean, there, it went from many different levels. From bullshit talk to just absolutely insane. She'd take anybody.
Well, everybody. One thing you can take to heart, we talked to everybody today, and they had
nothing but good things to say about her.
Nothing but good stuff to say about her.
Hell of a lady. Hell of a lady. She was. And Larry was, too. I mean, he do anything for anybody. You know, never shut anybody out. You know, you need some help, I'm going to help you out.
Well, at least we know what Gracie looked like.
Yeah.
So.
All right, man.
I appreciate it.
Hey, it's not a problem.
It means a lot. You guys have no idea.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Thank you. You're
Thank you.
Okay, so, we're out here in Malvern, Iowa, and we're getting ready to go into this trailer, which is pretty much attached to this building. Malvern Manor, Niche Cottage, I can't remember how to say that, whatever you want to call it. This actual trailer was actually owned by Geraldine. She lived in here, she loved this place, so we're going to come in here and see if we can maybe speak with her a little bit. We got a little bit of information from a relative of hers, Mike. He came out here, you've probably already seen him, but one thing he did say out here was Geraldine loved her dog. Loved her so much, she had the dog stuffed and sat pretty much right there for most of what Mike can remember. So we're coming in here to see if we can speak to Geraldine or maybe even the little pooch, I don't know. You want to start us off there, John?
Hey, Geraldine, are you sad how the state of your building that you love so much has deteriorated? Are you and your husband together now since he's passed away?
Larry, did you come back here to join Geraldine at your guys' favorite place? We would love to speak with Larry or Geraldine to get a little bit more information about why you love this place so much. So if you would, please come over here and join us. Folks, it is pretty dusty in here. Just to let you know.
Felt something like poke me in the butt. Back, well, almost. Like right above the butt crack. You know, like when I was sitting there coughing and shit. Felt something like boop.
Huh. Checking the boop button.
Are you guys, Geraldine, are you guys at home with some of your patients that are still here and haven't left yet? Did you just poke Dave in the butt? Yourself in and
sounds good to
investigating.
Me. Yeah, let's go do this.
With nothing happening in the trailer, we moved our attention inside.
All right, I think we made, I don't know why, but I think I'm
static here. All right, folks, if you haven't seen us before, this is a device called the SB7 Spirit Box. Well, this is not it. This is a speaker for the Spirit Box. What I have right here is the Spirit Box. And what this does is it cycles through FM frequencies, or I think you can even send them to AM frequencies as well, I think. But it cycles through them at a fast rate, so that as you end up talking and asking questions, if you get a response that's a solid response coming through, you know it's not any contamination from any other frequencies such as walkie-talkies, radio stations, and the other. Where did I drop that? There it is.
Bottom right-hand corner of the thing is the power button.
Oh, is it? Okay.
Hold it down.
If there's any spirits with us, can you tell us your name? Can you tell us the name of the people, the man and wife that used to own this place?
Can you try to tell us the name of the previous owners one more time, please?
Heard Kine, I really think.
Really? Yeah.
That was Geraldine's last name.
Really? Why did that light all of a sudden come on?
Shouldn't unless somebody pushes the button.
As you've seen, I've been here with my hands in my pocket and it just kicked on.
I did.
But thank you for coming and speaking with us. Can you tell us your name? Here? Should eventually go back off, right? Are you keeping
see
that?
See if there's like a backlight button on there.
Yep, there's the backlight button. So that had to have been touched. Hey, can you come over here and turn that light on again?
Yeah.
Awesome.
I hate to sound like Zach Bagans, but there was a couple times that I seemed like an orb. But one came from John, came up, stopped, and came down and went to you. And then right after it went to you, it sounded like it came through and said David on here. I'm just saying.
What did it say?
Shit right there. But it said, it sounded like it said David at that point. But you'll have to see the video.
Can you tell me one of our names?
Yeah.
Thank you, that was awesome.
Can you tell us what town we are in?
Just said it.
You just said it. That's a chills on my back. How many people are in this room with us? I don't feel like going home.
you need.
Well, I'm not sure if that was actually it or not, but it sounded like a little bit. Do you want to go home?
Cut that. Cut it.
Oh, cut it.
Did one of you make that bumping now, sound? John?
I haven't moved.
I haven't moved.
That one there too?
What?
You didn't hear that one there?
No.
I've been hearing it while that was going off, that's why I had to cut the thing. It almost sounded like footsteps to me.
Like directly behind you or outside?
I can't tell where it's coming from. I could hear like a few of the bump sounds, so.
Huh. Well, you know what? Seems like you may have walked out of here on us. If you didn't, try to light up the backlight on this thing again, like you did earlier. Otherwise, we're going to go ahead and mosey on out of here onto the next section.
There we go. Alright, so what we're doing here is a little fun thing we like to do. It's called send Barry in funny places and see what he can find out. So what I'm doing right now is I'm actually heading upstairs to spend some time by myself up in these hallways. See what happens. So, I'm actually sitting in one of the hallways down here by room 17 and 18, where supposedly a gentleman would go from room 18 over to room 17, or vice versa, and apparently rape that guy that was in there for about 3 times a week. No one's corroborated that story, so we're just trying to come up here and see what we can figure out. You know what? It was kind of weird coming up here at first. Because it's fairly dark. Because you pretty much don't see anything in here. Alright, so, my name is Barry. Can you tell me your name? I think I might mosey into one of these rooms real quick. It might be a little crazy, but I don't know. Alright, let's go check some of this stuff out. Gentleman was kind of sexually assaulting the one across the hall. I'm gonna go in here, see if I feel anything. But of course you end up usually feeling chills across your body, especially when you go into cold, dark areas that by yourself. So my name's Barry. I heard whoever was in this room was pretty ruthless to the neighbor. Sexual assault happened, from what we've been told. I don't accuse anyone of doing anything. But would you please come over here and set us straight? Tell me a few things about you. Well, I'm gonna go ahead and take a stroll down over here to room 17 to see if someone over here might want to talk. Is there anyone in here who would like to speak with me? Stories going around about someone who was in this room who was hurt by the gentleman across the hall. Were you this person? If so, I have a camcorder or a nice little black box up there with what is a mic on top of that. You can respond inside that, to that mic, and it'll let me hear you. Were you sexually assaulted while you were staying at the cottage?
In both room 18 and 17, Barry felt cold chills, which seemed to be a precursor to what was about to happen.
Hey, fine. I'll just leave you alone. Seems like nothing's really going on up here. I'm not gonna lie, the majority of the time I'm up here, I don't know if it's because it's cold, but I kind of have like tinglies, goosebumps, that kind of sort of thing going on with my body. I don't know why. But I'm gonna go ahead and move to the other end of the hall, see if there's any kind of feeling that I may get from down there. So let's move on down. I don't know if it's something that's up here or what's going on, but I keep getting chills. I don't know if it's because it's pretty cold. It is really chilly outside at this time. Not nearly as cold inside, but I mean, I still could be getting wind chills possibly.
Said it came all of a sudden.
And that's why we do some weird fucked up shit. To see what happens.
Sudden, yeah. I saw you just like set the camera down and then you just stayed bent over. I'm like, the fuck? And then I seen, I don't know, it kind of looked like you were, heaving a little bit, and I was like, oh, shit.
He was stretching there for a while.
He's like, he's just stretching his back. And
like a normal dude, yeah.
No. Anybody will see on the video, I was over there.
Yeah.
Went into 18. As soon as I walked through the doors, I was getting a tingle, like goosebumps, chill, cold chills or whatever, along my back. And throughout the time I was in there. Then I went across the hall in 17. While I was over there, I just got a couple chills on my back. I was just knocking it off to probably cold, wind, something like that.
Yeah, like a breeze coming through or a leak.
Uh-huh, and then I made it to the bend on the other hallway. I got a full body chill, and then I went down.
Before John and I went upstairs to set up static detectors, I set up a camera so we could see the impact that this experience had on Barry as it finally set in. This clip will remain uncut.
Got your cross on?
Uh-huh.
I'm going to run these upstairs real quick. You guys going to hang out here until I come back?
No, you can't go up there alone.
Here, I'll go.
Careful,
trying to make sense of it. Mm-hmm. Don't dwell on it too much, because the more you dwell on it, the more you're going to get worried about it.
It could have just been all that dust that you collected over in the trailer.
Well, I don't get the sensation of being scared or fearing stuff at these investigations. And I don't know why I'm feeling that right now.
It could be everything playing in your head that we discussed throughout the day, throughout the interviews.
Yeah.
This is why we push ourselves.
Yeah.
These are the moments.
I'm gonna go sit in that fucking wheelchair.
Huh?
I'm gonna go sit in that fucking wheelchair.
So what we're getting ready to do is I'm gonna go in one part of this hallway back here by the nurses station. John's gonna go part of the hall in the nursing station. And Barry is taking on Gracie's room. And hopefully some reactions will come out of that room. We didn't really try much in her room, so we'll see what happens. So we're gonna go back there and kick some A.
Yeah, let's go see it.
This is your stop, Barry.
Yep, I was gonna say, this is the stop.
Good luck. Set up your camera wherever you want. See if you can get some interaction with the ball.
Problem hollering over here.
Alright.
We're gonna put it where it's open. So we're all split up down here in the nurses' wing, or the nurses' station wing. I took this hallway. John is all the way on the other side of this hallway. And down in Gracie's room is Barry. And we are going to try to communicate with somebody that might be down here. Right here where I'm located, there's been a sighting of a shadow figure shuffling along the wall. Gracie's room, there's Jason, who was on the night before. He actually felt pressure within his thighs and on his legs. And down towards John is where the office was for, what was his name?
Larry.
For Larry and the former owner of the nursing home. And let us begin.
When we got to our spots, my camera audio and digital recorders picked up this voice that seemed to be possibly saying a name. Here is the recorder audio matched with the camera audio.
Setting the recorder right here on this fuzzy thing.
Personality asked about.
If you can hear my voice. John, are you moving?
Just scratched my head, bro.
Okay. If you can hear my voice, can you come to it? Come down here. You're not in trouble. What's your last name? How long have you been here? Are you able to see us?
Although we kept hearing movement in the halls, our experiences remained questionable.
What I have in my hand is a primitive device, basically. You can tell by the way it looks. This was actually based off of a design by Thomas Edison himself. And what it does, theoretically, is it takes energy and it converts it to an audio format. We're going to run it from this to this digital recorder, and when we play it back, for the last few times we've used this, we haven't been able to hear anything, no voices, nothing, just complete silence. But from time to time, you'll hear pops and clicks coming from it on the recorder. This is something that's experimental. We're going to be tweaking it from here on out. Trying to change it, trying to figure out, you know, what works, what doesn't work. And tonight we're going to run this to see if anything in here is able to use its energy to communicate through this. So let's set this right here in the middle of the floor. Grab my trusty flashlight. We'll plug in to the headset, so it records directly into the microphone, actually, not the headset.
My bad.
Okay, we're in the microphone. We'll set the recorder right here. Power it on. And we will record. And the cool thing about this is we can be around this, and it will not pick up our voice, because our voice isn't the energy that will go through these coils. So, we're going to leave this here for now. We'll come back to it and analyze the data later. So, let's go.
We were setting up for a final session when we heard a woman moaning loudly from the second floor.
Just heard a woman howl or something. It was weird. Hello? Can you do that again? We heard you. Ma'am? Hello? Whoever that was, I want you to know that we were able to hear you. Stairs, upstairs. Can you tell us your name, please?
Try really hard. We heard you again. You rolling on your camera, Barry?
Yep. After hearing it again, we went up and found nothing. The night flew by and dawn approached rapidly. There was no doubt in our minds that someone or something was here and willing to make contact. The long history and disturbing events cannot overshadow the emotions generated and left behind. For us and those who have walked the halls of the manor, there is no doubting Malvern Manor's haunting history.
I've begun to question a lot more since doing all the experiments. It's almost like I don't trust myself anymore sometimes.
I'm telling you, this place is a ghost town.
Bullshit!
Just like that.